Well, what's the take where you are, Stephanie, about what these guys have been through in the past week or so?
Which guys?
Lyft. yeah, exactly. Which constituency? Good question.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you, as you guys have talked about on this show and as CNBC has been talking about throughout the week, you know, this is an example of a company that is not profitable, where there are still a lot of questions about the earnings potential. A lot of the earnings growth is going to come from something that will happen in the future, which is driverless cars, and therefore getting rid of a lot of their labor costs. And so, you know, it should come as no surprise that this is going to be a bumpy ride, not just this week, but for the foreseeable future.
Kevin, what should investors specifically take away from this idea? Because it seems to me if the company itself gets all the money that it can out of the IPO, that means the price is as high as they can possibly get it, which means for the retail investor, there's increased downside, right? So almost you're betting against the company's interest as a retail investor out of the gate. And from the retail investor's perspective, they've kind of lost. The people who bought in on the first day at 80-something, not so happy now, though it's still early.
Yeah, I think there are two things to take away from this. The first one is that Lyft is the first of the really big high-profile tech IPOs we're going to see this year. And as you point out, it's actually a good lesson for investors to watch and see what happened. It's instructional that people don't have unrealistic expectations about what happens in an IPO. Lyft, the second thing is Lyft is like particularly hard to value because it's an unprofitable company that says to grow, it's going to likely become increasingly less profitable. There's no point in the horizon where you can see this being a company that is profitable with any confidence today. And so it's an instructional IPO to look at as an individual investor, because you see what happens. The company's going to price this as rich as they can. You're an individual investor. You get in on IPO day. You're there. You have your buy order in. You buy above everybody. And it's a struggle to get back to that price. And we also see that it's really hard to value this company at this point.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that, Stephanie, the linchpin here in terms of a company like Lyft becoming profitable is going to be this bet on autonomous driving. We've had investors on our air who have actually suggested maybe we never actually get fully autonomous driving and driverless cars. I mean, what happens then?
Well, I think then they go through what every company goes through, which is they're going to have to start looking at ways to cut costs. I mean, I look at the amount of money that Lyft spends on marketing, and it is phenomenal. I mean, they are, yeah. And it's not just the traditional marketing, but it's, you know, sponsoring concerts and getting people rides to rap events. I mean, they are doing all kinds of creative things because, you know, they're in that phase where they're trying to acquire customers. So I think that, you know, as a public company, they're going to have to start looking really hard at costs if this bet on autonomous doesn't go their way.
We just saw this week there was this experiment, I think it was in China, where people were putting markers on the road basically that were designed to redirect driverless cars, autonomous cars. It was a good reminder that the path from here to safe, ubiquitous autonomous driving out in the places where people want to travel, not just in controlled campus environments, is actually pretty long, and there are these issues. If you can put stickers on a road or paint symbols on a road and cause cars to veer into oncoming traffic, that's a problem.
Shorter term, are companies rewriting their S-1s to create a narrative that is a clearer path to profitability, these names that we expect to come to market later this year? Is that actually happening, do you think?
I can't answer that question. I mean, I think there are going to be companies that are going to try to create a narrative that makes makes them more attractive to investors. I think there are also going to be companies that, you know, quite honestly, you have to be really honest and forthcoming in these S-1s. And if you don't have the answer to that question, you probably aren't going to go down that path.
I think what we do see is that companies that are probably a little bit more mundane in some ways might actually have an easier answer to the question. So you have Lyft, which is this massive thing, but you also have Pinterest, which is, you know, a bit more mundane, not a name necessarily that investors have been frothed up around to get finally the opportunity to invest in. But that's likely to become profitable much more quickly than Lyft. And so that's an interesting way to look at the different S-1s we're going to see.
We'll see if that ends up being the case.